Hello everyone, I'm Kevin, and today I'm going to talk to you about my story. As I have mentioned in a few other videos, I don't have a relationship to my parents. I know that June means a lot of different things to a lot of different people. For a lot of people, it's Pride Month, and it's like this happy, you know, the start of summer and pride. Everyone gets to be proud of who they are and see themselves in the world. And it's summer, the weather is warmer and stuff like that as well. But for me, June, it was the hardest month of my life so far. And it's been 2 years now. And I want to do this video as well, as this is the first video in a series about being the child of toxic parents and being a child of who is no contact with their parents. The reason for that is because I think our stories are important, and I know how big a difference it would have made for me if I had that kind of video to look at, you know? But as it is now, a lot of videos that talk about toxic parents are created by people who are not children of toxic parents, but instead psychologists and psychiatrists and people who work with like mental illnesses and people with this trauma that we have. And I want to just start out by saying that I'm happy. I have a good life. I have two cats that are extremely annoying, but I love them regardless. And I live in a city that I absolutely adore. I have the best job in the world for me, and I'm going to work there full time this autumn. And I love this apartment that I got, and just a lot of things in my life are great. I have started hormone replacement therapy as a trans person, so I'm going through that as well. So you might hear a difference in my voice, and that's why. But I just wanted to start out by saying how happy I am, like, with my life. And I want to share that happiness because it's possible. Like, for a lot of us, like 2 years ago, I would never have thought it was possible for me to ever be happy again. And here I am. And that's why I wanted to start out this video by saying that. So all of you watching who have a similar story to me in any regard, you know that it will get better. How long it will take before it gets better, it depends on a lot of things. But for me, these past 1 year, I'm not gonna say the past 2 years, but the past year has been great for me. And that also feels very, like, weird, to be honest, you know, that my life became a lot better when I lost my parents, but I get it. And people who also are children of toxic parents and children who are no contact, meaning they don't have contact with their parents, know that when we escape from that toxicity and that abuse and manipulation, gaslighting and all of that, and we choose ourselves, we choose happiness. We choose our lives and the possibility to be happy. I love myself today in a way that I've never loved myself before. I am proud of myself today in a way I've never been proud of myself before. So this video is to give you a little insight to my story, what happened with me, between me and my parents 2 years ago. And it is not an easy story to tell. It is not an easy story to hear. And I am here with a warm cup of coffee, as well as my favorite hoodie. It says Deutschland, and it has a Deutsche Adler on it. I love this shirt. It's so cozy. But I am prepped with coziness. So in case, I just want to say that I understand if this is going to be very difficult for people to hear, especially if you have the same kind of story as me. Like, if you are also a child of toxic parents, if you also, like, regardless if you have a relationship to them today or not, I understand if it's difficult, if it's gonna be difficult. That's also why I wanted to tell you about today, like, how I feel today, how I am today, so that you know that going into this video. But also, before we start with the actual video, I want to give you a little background that I think is necessary. And the first thing is that I've been struggling with mental illnesses. I have been struggling with mental illnesses since I was a child. The earliest time that I know for a fact that I self-harmed, I was 6 years old. So I have self-harmed since I was 6 years old. I haven't self-harmed for over a year now, which I am extremely proud of myself for, considering how often I did that growing up. I also have a history of suicidal thoughts as well as suicide attempts. And that's a little bit like information going into this. And for the past 5 years, I have been on different medications for my mental illnesses. I have also seen my contact person. She is a psychiatric nurse, and I've been seeing her regularly for the past 5 years. So that is just a little bit of like in background, because we're going to go into those things. And I guess that's also a little bit of, I guess, content warning as well. I'm not going to go into depth about those feelings or those issues, but I wanted to give you that kind of insight first. So 2 years ago, in the middle of May 2019, I was hospitalized for suicide prevention. I was in such a bad state mentally. I couldn't function. I couldn't do anything. I didn't eat, because when I'm really depressed, I stop eating. So I didn't eat and I didn't do anything, and I had my cats that I had to take care of, and I knew that I couldn't go on that way because my cats deserve better. So I went to the psychiatric emergency room that we have, and I was hospitalized for suicide prevention, and I was hospitalized for 10 days. The only person in my family that I told that I was hospitalized was my granny, who is my dad's mom. And once I was, like, the day after I was hospitalized, like when I had been hospitalized for a full day, she told me that she had to tell my parents, and I said, yeah, okay. And so she told my parents, and my parents told everyone in the family. So suddenly I had like phone calls and text messages from my sisters. I have two older sisters and an older brother, but my sisters contacted me, and my other grandparents on my mom's side contacted me, and my parents of course contacted me as well. And the thing is that a lot of people don't know is that, like, I got that question a lot, like, but you're hospitalized, it's like we should treat it the same way as if you were hospitalized for a surgery or a broken bone, you know. But the thing is, my body wasn't broken, it was my mind that was broken, and I didn't have a lot of energy. Like, when you're that depressed, you don't have a lot of energy, and having people contact you, even if it's from a place of love, it affects you mentally. And for me personally, I can't speak for anyone else with mental illnesses, I always pretended to be better than I was, or to feel better than I was. And when people called me and told me that they were so worried and stuff, then I was the one to comfort them and say, no, you don't have to worry, it's fine, and stuff like that. Even though I kind of needed it to be the other way around. Like, I kind of would have wanted, like, them telling me that you're gonna be okay. Like, you're in safe hands, you're gonna be okay. But instead, I got a lot of, and I know that's, like, I don't blame anyone in my family for reacting like that. It's just a thought that I have today that I didn't have 2 years ago. Me being hospitalized for suicide prevention affects them negatively. Like, that's not something that I need to hear when I'm hospitalized for suicide prevention. Like, I already felt very badly about myself, and so hearing that I and my mental illnesses affect someone else badly is not something that I need to hear when I already feel bad. You know what I mean? I hope you know what I mean. I heard from one of my sisters that my parents were on their way up to me. Like, I live 10 hours north of where they live. And I found out from my sister that my parents were planning to come up and visit me at the hospital. And so I contacted my parents and I said that I would appreciate it if they wouldn't come up here because it wouldn't help me if they did. And I understand, like, that sounds very strange. Like, of course my parents weren't gonna be very happy about that, you know? But all I needed from them was saying, like, okay. And then once I was out of hospitalization, we could talk about why. But that was something that I didn't have the mental capacity to do at the time. But my mom replied and said that we're not going up to the city for you. We're going up there for us because we want to be close to you. And I said, okay, fine. Like, if that's something that you want to do, do it. But I'm not gonna accept visitors because I'm not accepting visitors. The only persons, like, I only had my two friends in this town from university. They came over once on the 10 days that I was hospitalized, because it was very difficult to be social. You know, when I was in that mental state, it was very difficult to be social with anyone because, as I said, I always tend to pretend to feel better than I do so as not to upset anyone else. But my parents came up to the city and they said that they wanted to help me and asked, what can we help you with? And a lot of stuff. And I said, there's nothing you can help me with. I don't have my keys. My friends have my keys and they're taking care of my cats and all of that. So, like, there's nothing that I can give them to help me with because I didn't have access to those things anymore. And they said, like, we want to visit you. And I said, like, I don't want to have visitors. And I'm happy that they respected that I didn't want visitors. They kept, like, messaging, like, yeah, we understand that, just take care of yourself. And also, like, saying that to, like, you have a kid who is hospitalized, like, I get it, you want to be close to that kid, but if your kid says that it's better for me if you don't, like, I think you should respect that. And if you feel, like, as I said, like, if you feel bad that, okay, my kid doesn't want me to visit, like, why is that? Then you can have, like, you respect your kid who is hospitalized. Like, they are hospitalized for a reason. And if it was easy for them to see you, they would have been happy. Like, yeah, come on, like, come over, like, visit. That would be so great. But if they react the way that I did, that please don't come up, it wouldn't help me, like I said that, then respect that, stay where you are. And once your kid is no longer hospitalized for suicide prevention, you can have that talk, like, hey, while you were hospitalized, why didn't you want us to visit you? And they could say, yeah, it's because I don't have, like, I didn't have the mental capacity, I didn't have enough energy back then to talk or to have visitors, because it would take so much out of me that I need to focus on me getting better, or something like that. Like, as a parent, you have to, or as a friend, as anything, you have someone who is hospitalized for the same reason that I was. Respect, like, if the person says, I want you to visit me, respect that, and if you can, do it. If you can't, that is, of course, fine. But also, if the person who is hospitalized for suicide prevention tells you, please don't visit me because it wouldn't help me. Hi, editing Kevin here. I just wanted to add that for some people who are hospitalized for mental illnesses, no matter if it's suicide prevention like I was, some of us do not want anyone to see us when we feel that bad. Like, seeing us at our absolute lowest is not something that is easy to invite someone in and say, like, seeing me at my absolute worst. So I just wanted to bring that up. You have to respect that as well. And I just wanted to explain why, because, like, that is something that I've struggled with. Like, oh my God, I'm such a bad kid, because I didn't even let my parents visit me, like, what kind of monster am I? But that's because I always had to put other people before myself. And while I was hospitalized, I had to put myself first, because if I would have let people, like, if I would have let them visit me, I would have pretended to be better than I was. And because I know my parents, I know that my mom would be like, she would cry and she would be so upset that I was there and I would have to comfort her, which is, in my opinion, it's wrong. Like, I am hospitalized, I should only take care of myself. But then a few days later, I got a call from my granny and she yelled at me. She was not happy with me because apparently my parents had come to the clinic, come to the door, and I turned them away, which did not happen. Like, my parents had told her that I didn't let them visit me. And, like, my granny was so mad at me because my parents went all the way up to my city and I wouldn't even let them visit me. And I told them, like, the first time, when, as soon as I found out that my parents were planning to visit me in my city, I told them not to come. So I don't know why they're surprised that I didn't want them to visit me, because I said from the first moment that I knew that they were planning to, that it wouldn't help me. And my parents seemed supportive, like, yeah, we understand that, focus on yourself, get better. But to Granny, they didn't tell the full story. They just said that I wouldn't let them visit me. Like, they didn't say that I told them not to come to my city at all. I didn't, like, I told them from the get-go, don't come here, it won't help me. And they said that they were going to come here for them because it would help them, even though it wouldn't help me. They did it for themselves. That's what they told me. But of course they didn't tell my granny that. And so when granny, like, yelled at me and was so mad at me for how I treated my parents, I felt so confused. Because my parents had been supportive, like, when they talked to me, they were supportive, but when they talked about me, they were not supportive. And that was just, like, I still, like, I didn't think more of it, like, I blamed myself, because that's, like, when you're in that kind of, like, mental state, I felt like everything was my fault. I felt I was suicidal, like, I was hospitalized for suicide prevention. I didn't want to live. And I got a lot of reasons that made me feel like I don't deserve to live, because I make my parents feel that way. Like, I am causing my parents harm, so why should I live? That kind of thing. Which, of course, did not help me. But that was while I was hospitalized. But after 10 days, I was hospitalized for 10 days. And before I was discharged, I told everyone, like, I talked to everyone in my family that I was in contact with. I told my friends, like, please don't contact me. When I have the energy, I will call you. I will, like, just please be patient with me because I need time. And the thing is also that you're discharged doesn't mean that you're fully recovered. Like, if you're hospitalized because you had a surgery, you're not discharged once you're completely healed. You're discharged when the hospital staff says you can now take care of yourself. You no longer need our assistance. That's when you're discharged. And the same goes for being hospitalized for mental illness. I wasn't discharged because my doctors thought that I was fully recovered and now I could live my life without my mental illnesses or anything like that. Instead, I was discharged because I was no longer a threat to my own life. So that's why I was discharged. I wasn't discharged because I was fully recovered and happy and no longer depressed. I was discharged because I wasn't a threat to my own life anymore. Because I was hospitalized for suicide prevention. I was surrounded by hospital staff to prevent me from taking my life. But when I no longer was a threat to my own life, they let me go. That's why I was discharged. I wasn't discharged because I was fully recovered. And also, like, when I got home, I was still in a very, like, bad state mentally. like as I said, I was still very much depressed. I was still very much full of anxiety and stuff like that. And I still struggled a lot. And I had just a very limited amount of energy. And for me, I could only do one thing a day. So I bought this like whiteboard calendar, and I wrote one thing for every day that I had to do for that day. And when I did it, I was exhausted. And it could be like clean the apartment. It could be like go out, like recycle things, buy groceries, cook everything. So I had like meal boxes for the entire week, study because I had an exam the following, like the Friday. So 1 week after I was discharged, that same week on Friday, I had an exam that was the entire course grade. So I had a lot of like things that I had to do, and I had a timer on my phone for every 2 hours, because every 2 hours I had to eat something. Like it didn't have to be a full meal box. It could be a banana. It could be like something. At least I ate something. Like I literally had to remind myself to eat. Otherwise I would completely forget to eat, which is an issue that I have when I'm depressed and mentally down or something. But I have like that limited amount of energy that I put into doing these different things. And I was also very much stressed about the exam that I had, which would be the last exam of the semester. And on first day, while I was at the university, I was studying in a group room. I had my computer, I had my textbooks, I had my phone. I had everything in front of me so that I could prepare for the exam that was the next day. And on first day, in the morning, my mom called. And this first day was the 6th of June, 2019, which is exactly 2 years from today. Like, my mom called, and I picked up the phone, and I said, hey. And the first thing that my mom said to me, like, the first 3 words, I am mistreated. That was the first thing that she told me. Like, after I was hospitalized for suicide prevention, the first thing my mom tells me is that she's mistreated. And I asked her, like, why are you mistreated? And she said that, well, because you haven't called me, and you've probably called everyone else, but you haven't called me. And I tried to explain to her that, no, I have not called everyone but you. I haven't even been discharged. I haven't been out of hospitalization for a full week. And, like, I have so much going on in my life. Like, I haven't called everyone but you. And I tried to explain to her that I didn't have enough energy. Like, as someone who had, like, mental illness, who was in a very, very dark place, I was still in the same state that I was when I was hospitalized. The only difference was that I was no longer suicidal. Or rather, I was no longer planning to take my life. I was still suicidal, but I wasn't a threat to my own life. And I tried to explain to her that I didn't have enough energy to call. And she took that personally. And she said that, what are you going to do this summer? We have a summer house. And like she said that, what are you going to do this summer with the summer house now that we take your energy? I told her, I don't know. I'm going to focus on my own well-being so that I don't have to choose between suicide and hospitalization. And her response to that was, have a good life then, Kevin. And then she hung up. And I was so shocked, and I felt so guilty, because I felt like it was my fault. Like, of course, I felt like it was my fault. My mom felt mistreated because of me, and like I felt very guilty about that. And the fact that she said, have a good life then, Kevin, and stuff like that. And I was just so broken. Like, I broke down. I couldn't do anything. I called my friends and I told them what happened. It's so weird to think back on that moment, because I felt like it was on me, that this call was on me. It was my fault. But today, I think, like, it hit me a few months ago, really, that, like, it feels so weird, because, like, I can't imagine if her first words had been, how are you? How are you doing? Or, I know you said that you're gonna call when you can, but I just wanted to know how you're doing. Like, I can't imagine that. And that really hit me, that I can't imagine my mom would say that. Like, I can imagine that. Like, I think that says a lot. Back then, like 2 years ago today, I was so used to that kind of, like, that my mom would say things like that, that I immediately tried to comfort her and take care of her and see to what she needed instead of her actually, like, out of the two of us, I was just discharged from hospitalization, but I had to take care of her, and I really felt like me asking for patience was asking for too much, which I also think is so weird. And this is something that feels very strange to me, because for me, I feel like I deserve that. Like, the things that she said to me, I should have understood that that was what was going to happen. Like, I should have expected her to say those things. And I felt stupid that I hadn't expected it. Like, it's very weird, I think. And, like, as I said, I was not in a good state after that. Like, I was very messed up mentally after that. I was not good. And on Friday, the next day, I had my exam. I couldn't do anything. Like, I barely answered any of the questions. I just handed it in. And I couldn't think. I couldn't do anything. So I just, there was absolutely nothing I could have done. On that day, on Friday, my granny talked to me and she said that I had to fix it. I had to call my parents and fix this because she needed to know about the summer house, how we're gonna do with it and stuff like that. And she was just on me to fix it. And today, I think it's so weird, honestly, that I had to be the one to fix it. I don't know if granny asked or told mom to do the same, like if she called mom and said, you have to fix it with Kevin or something like that. I don't know. I have no idea if she did that. I don't think so, but I don't know. Like, for me at that point, I felt like, yeah, of course it's on me to fix it with my mom. And I was so annoyed. I remember I was extremely annoyed because all I wanted to do was have time to take care of myself. And here I was, and I had to fix something with my mom because me wanting patience mistreated her. But so on Saturday morning, I called my dad and he didn't pick up. So I called my mom and she picked up, and I just told her that I wanted to talk about our last call. And she said that it wasn't a good call for her. And I said, yeah, I understand that, but I want to know about, like, how you think of the summer house. And I asked, like, I told her that I would understand if she wouldn't feel comfortable if we were at the summer house at the same time. And she told me, yeah, it wouldn't be vacation if you're there with us. And that feels so weird to me that she could say that to her kid who was just hospitalized for suicide prevention, which she knew. Like, she knew everything. Like, she knew about my history with suicide attempts, with self-harming, with, like, my depression, my anxiety. She knew I was hospitalized for all of it, that my medication was increased, but she still told me that I would ruin her vacation if I was at the summer house with her, because that's exactly what someone who just got out of suicide prevention needs to hear. But back then, I felt like I deserved it. And later that night, still Saturday, mom and dad called me on dad's phone. And in this call, I found out that mom was taking medication because she couldn't sleep at night because of me. And I found out that she was sad all the time. And she literally said that she didn't know if she was ever going to be happy again because of me. And my dad told me that I had been using them. And the last thing that they said to me was, we'll see or hear from each other again. And then they hung up. And, like, what really bothers me is the fact that I believed them, because of course I believed them, you know? I was hospitalized for suicide prevention and they knew everything. Like, as I said, they knew all of my history. I had talked about them at length about all of it. They knew I was hospitalized. They knew I was hospitalized for my mental illnesses. And after that last call, I believed that it was all of this was my fault. Like, I mistreated mom. I would ruin mom's vacation. I'm the reason mom is sad all the time. I'm the reason my mom has to take medication to sleep. I drove my parents to leave me. Like, at that point, at that night, Saturday, after the last call, I believed them. Because, of course, I believed them. And I already had such a, and I already had such a skewed worldview, and view of myself. Like, I was a bad person. Like, I was still very, very mentally unstable. And, like, I don't understand. No, like, back then, I believed them. I thought they were right, and I thought everything was my fault, and I didn't deserve to live. And, like, what... And really, like, what... Something that I would love to ask them, like, if I ever see them again, I would want to know. Like, just giving the facts, like, you have a kid who is hospitalized, which you know this kid is hospitalized for mental illnesses, that the medication is increased, and all of that. You know this kid has a background of suicidal thoughts, suicide attempts, and self-harming. You know this kid has been on medications for 5 years and seen a psychiatric nurse for 5 years. You know this kid, before being discharged from hospitalization, tells you to give them time so that they can focus on themselves, and they will contact you when they can, when they feel like they are able to. You know all of this. And you call this kid and you tell them that you are mistreated, that this kid would ruin your vacation. You're telling this kid that they are the reason that you can't sleep at night without taking medication. You're telling this kid that you don't know if you'll ever be happy again because of them. And you tell this kid that they're using you, and you're telling this kid that you'll see or hear from each other again. What do you think this kid will do? And that's the reason I can never forgive them, even though they've never apologized. Like, I have met them 3 times in total these past 2 years, and they've never apologized. And, like, I can't forgive them. I can't tell them that it's okay, even though, like, the first time that I saw them after this whole thing, my mom said, well, it wasn't that bad, you know? As if all of those things weren't that bad. And, like, that was, like, I can't forgive them for all of this. And I felt so stupid. Like, back then, all of Friday, like, we had the first call on Thursday, nothing on Friday, just me talking to Granny. And then on Saturday, the last 2 calls. And all of Friday, I kept waiting for my dad to call. Like, I expected my dad to call, and I feel so stupid because I expected my dad to call me and say, hey, I heard mom's perspective and now I wanted to hear yours, or I heard from mom what happened and I wanted to see how you're doing. But my dad was completely fine with breaking up contact with me after not even, like, my dad was completely fine breaking up contact with me without hearing my side, without asking my side, my perspective, my thoughts, how I'm feeling, how I'm doing. And I was literally just discharged from suicide prevention, and my feelings didn't matter to them. And I think, like, sometimes I feel like, okay, I'm being too hasty, like, I should understand that people say things in despair at the moment, you know? And then I think, like, no, that is not an excuse, because we had 1 call on Thursday. No contact on Friday, and the last 2 calls on Saturday. They had the entire day of Friday to think, yeah, maybe we're going too fast. Like, maybe we should slow down. Maybe we should think about Kevin, who was just hospitalized for mental illnesses, who we know is still mentally unstable because that's why he asked for time. But they didn't, and like, of course they didn't. And that's also something that hurts a lot. Like, it hurts a lot because it doesn't matter that I'm hospitalized. It doesn't matter if I'm feeling bad mentally, if I'm unstable mentally, if I'm going through things because of my mental illnesses, because I will never matter more to my dad than my mom. And I still think it's so weird and so skewed, honestly, that this even happened. Like, I think it's so weird that this actually happened. Like, sometimes I feel like, no, I'm making this up, but I didn't. Because the thing about me is, since I was a kid, I've heard again and again and again that I'm making things up. That I'm making something that is small into a bigger deal. That I have a great imagination and I'm exaggerating and stuff like that. And I heard from a very young age that I was just making things up and that I was just overly sensitive. So when I was young, like under 10, I don't remember like a specific age, but I was younger than 10, I know, I started writing down everything. So I started taking notes. So whenever I noticed like someone is saying like this thing that someone said to me is something that I am going to think about for a while now, I write it down so that I have it written down so that I know for a fact that this happened. This person said these things to me. And I have like, I have my old iPod Touch and I have so many notes on there that is just like, my sister just said this, my mom just said this, and like my friend just said this. And I have so many like quotes that people told me that I knew that I was going to think about. And when my mom told me that she was mistreated, I had my computer up because I was at university and I immediately wrote it down. So I have it still on my computer in notes. I have all of it. I have the conversations. I have excerpts from the conversations. I have everything on my computer. And it's to prove to myself that I'm not insane, the way that people, while I was growing up, made me feel like I was insane, that everything was happening inside my head when it was in fact actually happening in real life. And I have everything written down on my computer, and it gives me kind of like comfort to know that all of this actually happened. I have proof that everything happened, and like I know that. And that helps me a lot, that I have all of that. And I also think about like the entire thing, and I think about like what my granny told me, that I was the one to fix it. And I think that is so weird today, that the person who was just discharged from suicide prevention was the one to comfort, like clear things for my parents, I guess you can say. That I was the one to fix things. Like I had to grow up. I had to set aside my mental illnesses and how bad I felt, because my family, my granny needed me to fix things with my mom. And I think that's so weird. I think that's so weird that it was on me. Like I was 22 and I was so used to being the one to fix it. Like, I've been the one who fixes things since I was a child. Like, I was my parents' couple therapists. Like, I was the one, I was a tween, and I sat, and I had my mom and my dad, and I had a small bowl that I had, and I passed it. So now, dad, as long as you hold the bowl, it's your turn to speak. And whenever they had a conflict, it was me who had to be the objective person sitting in the middle and like giving word to whoever should speak. And you know, like that was my job. And like, I am the youngest of four kids. My oldest sister is 9 years older than me. My other sister is less than a year older than me. So like, why was it me? You know, like, I don't know. But I was the one who sat and cleared everything. So when they had a conflict, it was me. And my dad, in 2016, my dad called and said that he was divorcing my mom. And I said that, okay, if you think that's what you need to be happy, I support it. And I called mom and I talked for hours with mom every single day, hearing her talk shit about my dad and my granny. But I took it because my mom needed me at that, like in that moment, my mom needed me. So I listened for hours and hours and hours while she talked bad things about my dad. And because she was upset and she needed someone to talk to, and it had always been me, so it had to be me. And I kind of expected, I guess, that when the time came, that someone in my family would do the same for me. But they didn't. My oldest sister called, and she was crying, and telling me how much mom was crying, and I had to fix this. I had to make things up with mom because she was crying so much and she wasn't going to tell my sister what happened. My parents have still not told my older sister or mom's parents what happened. The only people who know what happened, the only people who know why I don't talk to my parents, granny, my parents, me, and my sister who is less than a year older than me. We are the only ones who know what happened. And like that really impacted my relationship to my older sister, my oldest sister, because she was always mom's best friend. Like they are so tight. They talk on the phone every day and like they are best friends. They have the same interests. They help, like they are just so incredibly close. And I didn't want to ruin that. Like I felt like when my mom's parents asked me what happened and when my oldest sister asked me what happened, I felt like I owed it to my parents to be the ones to explain to them, but my parents never explained it to them. Like, my parents never said anything, and I understand why they never said anything. And my oldest sister, she thought that I left my parents, that I'm the one who made that choice, even though it was them. But she called me, and she was very, like, crying, telling me that mom was crying, that mom was so upset because of me and I had to fix it. Like, I had to call mom and say that everything was okay, and I could not do that. Like, if I would call mom and say, hey, everything is okay, you can stop crying now, I would betray myself. And really, like, who in my family was calling me and saying, hey, like, it's okay, like no one called me to comfort me. People called me and told me to comfort mom. And that is also something that I think is very, like, hurtful. So now that I've told you my story, I want to go back to what I said in the beginning of this video. I am happy today. I have a job that I love. I love teaching. I love the school that I work at. I have amazing cats. I live in a beautiful city. And I live in a beautiful apartment. And I am extremely proud of who I am today because I made it. And these past 2 years, I had to grow up extremely quickly. I had to become self-sufficient very quickly. And I had to become fully independent very quickly. Everything in this apartment is everything I have. And everything I have comes from my own pocket. There are a few things that are gifted to me. But the majority of everything is what I have earned, what I have paid for myself. And it's been 2 very difficult years. I have had to go through this big journey with myself. But I am proud of who I am today, and I love who I am today. And that is something that I think is extremely important to end this whole video with, because it is important. Back then, 1 year ago, I didn't think I was gonna make it. I felt that, like, what is the point of going on? What is the point of living if I don't have that? If I don't have that support, if I'm doing everything alone, what is the point? But there is a point, because I have me, and that's enough. I love myself, and that's enough. I take care of myself, and that's enough. And sometimes I wish I had a better relationship to my parents, but it's not to my parents, it's to parents. Sometimes I wish that I had parents who could take care of me the way that my parents couldn't. But at the end of the day, I don't have that. And I have to make the best of a bad situation, and I have. And the thing is that thinking about my parents, if I would ever have a relationship with them, if I would ever go back to them, I am not the person that they left. That who I am today is someone who is strong, and I'm funny, and I'm kind, and I love life, and I take every day for what it is. I look at the bright side of life. I see everything that I have instead of everything I don't have. and I am happy about everything I have. And the person that they left was the person who would put everyone and anyone above myself. I would prioritize anyone's well-being over my own, but I don't do that anymore. Today, I choose myself. Today, I choose my own well-being. I do what's best for me instead of doing what's best for other people. I comfort myself when I'm sad, and I am happy. I don't think that I would ever, I don't think there's an alternate reality where what happened between me and my parents wouldn't happen. Because that threat, they have threatened to leave me since I was a child. Like, I was 6 years old and mom would pack her bags, go to the door, and dad would run into my room and yell at me and say that mom is leaving because of me and I had to go comfort her. And my parents have threatened to leave a lot in my life. And I have had to apologize and break myself for them. I have had to mend myself to be a person that my parents needed. I had to ruin myself to build myself the way that people wanted me to be. I had to sculpt myself to fit my mother and my dad's needs. But today I am my own person. I am completely myself, 100% original, whatever you want to say. And I love who I am. There is no going behind that. There's no going around it. I love who I am today. I am a strong person, and I love who I am. And the person I am today is someone I need to have, someone I need to be for myself. And I think that's necessary to talk about. And thank all of you for watching. Please leave a like if you enjoyed this. This is the first part of a series about being a child of toxic parents and what it's like and everything that kind of comes with it, I guess. And if you have any questions, please comment down below, tell me your thoughts. And if you have a story similar to mine and you want someone to talk to, you can always message me on Twitter. It's open for everyone. So you can just go to Twitter and message me and we can talk, because I know how important it is to feel like this person gets it. Like, you're not alone. You're not completely alone in the world. Because I felt that too. And that's the point of this video and this series, is to tell people who are like me that you're not alone. We are in this together. And I will see all of you next time. Goodbye.